Hi, you're listening to TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. Dealing with the healthcare system can be stressful even at the best of times, but how does someone with a compromised immune system do it? Today's episode is all about what it means to be vulnerable during a crisis. Leisse Wilcox is a coach, podcast host, and she's a cancer survivor going through chemotherapy and surgery just last year. She speaks passionately about understanding and overcoming fear and really finding comfort and gifts in even the most uncomfortable situations. And I just want to say that Leisse is at home. I'm at my home. We're using technology to speak. So welcome, Leisse.
Thank you so much for having me.
It's really good to have you. So why don't you just tell us a little bit about your story?
You bet. Right now, my job title is professional human and real life adult. And that came to be because I have this real intimate understanding of the human experience. How did that evolve from this really painful childhood, a really painful divorce, ultimately that culminated in a really painful breast cancer diagnosis when I was 36, a single mom of three and self-employed. Through all of this experience, I was looking back on my life and I realized at every given moment, I had been able to take this pain and turn it into something really beautiful and uniquely my own. And so I started to really hone my coaching practice around emotional alchemy, this process of turning something really dark, ugly, heavy, uncomfortable into something very light, airy, beautiful, and again, something that's so unique to you.
I love that emotional alchemy. That's really good. So, you know, you've been through some very difficult things in your life. Cancer is, you know, we both know cancer is hideous and extremely scary and can really take you to some dark places. We're now with a worldwide pandemic, a lot of people are really feeling anxious, scared, worried. And then if you have a compromised immune system, you're going through cancer treatment yourself, or there's a long list of health conditions that one can have where they're really vulnerable to a virus like this. Where does someone start in controlling their fear?
I think it starts with the acknowledgement of the fear. You know, it's so easy to feel fear. It's so easy to feel panic. We are inundated with messaging. We're inundated with messaging that doesn't necessarily fuel a great agenda. It fuels somebody else's agenda, not necessarily the agenda of the greater good, which is to be supportive, to be inclusive. So I think some people are just trying to out-positive it and just like stay super positive. That doesn't work because you're not confronting the fear. Some people are going the opposite route and really dwelling in that fear and the negativity and the toxicity. That doesn't work either because that just kind of celebrates the fear and it amps up your anxiety. When your anxiety is super amped up like that, it alters your physiology, which actually makes you more susceptible to getting ill. So there's this sweet spot in between that starts very simply by acknowledging, oh my God, I'm really afraid. This is making me feel really afraid. And then to level that up, start looking very intensely at where that fear comes from, what the root of that fear is, and being able to have the bravery to trace it back to where it's stemming from. You know, in a matter of a week, we went as a society, not everybody, but as a society as a whole, from living at like this top tier of a pyramid, you know, Maslow's hierarchy of needs. We were living in this state of really being interested in supporting our own needs for fulfillment, you know, psychological and self-awareness. And overnight, that system crumbled to put us back to meeting our foundational needs for basic human survival and security. This has been a radical shift and a radical trigger in so many different ways for the individual and for the collective. So by acknowledging that fear first and foremost, I think that's an excellent place to start.
Okay, so we've acknowledged we're scared. I think for most people, the fear is, well, not most people, but a lot of people, and I know it's crossed my mind, is that I'll get it and I'll die.
Yeah.
So there's my fear.
Yeah.
You know, and that's probably fear for a lot of people, especially if they're older or know that they will, this virus will be very bad for them. So once you've acknowledged that fear, then what do we do with it?
Well, then I think, again, we have to get very, very real at what is the story I'm telling myself. You know, that's a magical phrase here. And if that's the fear, I think I'm going to get it and I think I'm going to die. Well, that's the story you're telling yourself. Is that story true? The reality is for most people that is not true. The messaging that I don't think has been fully synthesized, and very admittedly, I'm on a very tight news diet because I can't handle it. I've definitely reduced my news consumption to about 20 minutes a day, once a day, and that's it. And I'm still getting all the information I need, but I'm not getting inundated with stuff that I don't need, right? But I think that if you look at it, the messaging that we're not necessarily getting is that this, all of these dramatic, sweeping, radical measures and changes that we're taking as a country, as a nation, it's being done to protect the hospitals and the healthcare system, which are already so maxed, they're just getting by doing what they can do. Heart attacks, broken bones, babies waiting to be born, like that stuff doesn't wait just because there's a pandemic. Hospitals are already maxed out. They're trying to do what they need to do, which is support us, and they can't do their jobs if they're getting an extra 1,000, 2,000, 10,000, 20,000 people coming in to emerge. So all of these sweeping measures are not because we're all going to get a virus and die. That's likely not going to happen for like 90% of the population. What it means is that we're shifting from thinking about me to thinking about we. And when we go from that shift from me to we start to think about what do my actions mean for our society at large? So when that fear comes back into place, the story you're telling yourself that you're going to get this virus and you're going to die, it's probably not a true story. So now you're allowed to let go of that narrative and instead shift into this fear of, well, I'm really afraid that I don't have any control. I'm really afraid that my kids aren't in school. I'm really afraid that I am now homeschooling and trying to run my business, or I don't have a job. Suddenly the stories are different, and we can start to address each of them as a different scenario on their own, which requires a great degree of honesty with ourselves.
Yeah. The narrative that we tell ourselves, right? And I think that, I mean, you see this probably all the time being a coach, is we're always telling ourselves these narratives that aren't true, right? A lot of us go to, you know, the worst case scenario.
Totally.
And this crisis has really highlighted.
Yeah.
The narrative of negativity for a lot of us. And so I love what you just said about, you know, identifying it and being honest with yourself and really grasping that. And it and also about the news. News is important. Information, reliable information is important. But boy, oh boy, I have to tell you, Leisse, when I start scrolling Twitter, my mental health takes a nosedive.
An immediate nosedive. And again, zooming out on this, you spending that much time on Twitter is already bad for your mental health, okay? You spending that much time on Twitter in a time when traditional news outlets have been starving for a bottom line, and all of a sudden it's like, well, we just got a whole bunch of content we can work with here. That's a reality. So now you've got a Twitter feed, which is already bad for your mental health. You've got extra news consumption of somebody else trying to better their own business and their own byline and their own bottom line. And you've got all your children at home. And all your travel plans just got canceled. And your job feels like it might be threatened for the next couple weeks, maybe the next couple months. And your partner is at home in a lot of cases, and you haven't spent like quality time together for any length of time, let alone an indefinite amount of time. So it's like, and all of the things that are going to take a radical toll on our emotional health are happening back to back to back with no warning, no amount of preparation, and they're happening in a cascade effect overnight. So it's like, we're stressed and like we're making it worse for ourselves.
Yeah, it's so true. Okay, so what about some, you know, steps or precautions for people who do have a compromised immune system? Oh, What are some things that people can do?
So when, I don't know about you, but when I did have cancer and when I was undergoing chemotherapy, I am a really healthy person. So suddenly shifting into the mindset for me of the natural defense my body was born with, I was, for my children, I always call them like the, our white knights, our white blood cells, knowing at a profound level that my biology was so compromised and my body did not have the normal defenses it needed to protect myself, it really changed my perspective. I really did not give a care about germs at all before. Suddenly starting chemo, I was like, germs are everywhere. Like germs are absolutely everywhere. I learned that I had to stay home. I had to rest. I fought it tooth and nail. I wrote a book proposal and I launched a podcast in that time too, but I did it from the couch, right? Like I forced myself to rest because my body forced me to rest. It forced me to take it easy. It forced me, like me, the capable, strong, independent, go-getter, driven woman that I am, it forced me to ask for help. And it forced me to ask for the right kind of help from the right kind of people. It did all these things. And so, you know, having empathy, I'm looking at the situation now. And if somebody is immunocompromised, those are the things, one of the biggest fears I keep hearing from my clients is like, I just feel like I have no control over this. Something you always have control over is how you respond, how you react, and how you take action in your own life. So even if you are one of the most vulnerable people in our society right now, nothing has changed in terms of how you can control your inner emotional environment, right? You need to ask people for help. So many grocery stores right now are doing free online grocery shopping. They're even offering delivery now. You know, your friends can help you with that, but you have to ask them for the right kind of help. Sometimes people have really great intentions and they want to offer help, but it actually isn't valuable to you. It does the opposite. You don't want more people in your house right now. Sorry, but you don't want any chance of that coming into your house right now. So someone offering to come in and clean or somebody offering to drop off food is not helpful. Somebody offering to drop it off at the door is really helpful. So suddenly now we're having a conversation with ourselves about what do my boundaries look like? Who are the people in my life that I safely and comfortably can ask for the right kind of help? And how do I, as a person, just say, man, I really appreciate your offer, but I'm going to say no, thank you for now. And I will reach out to you when I do need it.
And it's a good opportunity for people who have strong immune yeah. systems to all of a sudden think, wait a minute. Yeah. I know so-and-so and so-and-so, and maybe I could call, you know, I'm sure, you know, any of the cancer agencies would love to hear yeah. from a volunteer that is willing to just drive and drop off, drive yeah. and drop off food. So for those of us that are healthy, mm-hmm. that maybe can lend a hand, that's a good idea, isn't it?
I really think so. And to piggyback on what you're saying, I think sometimes there's just a need to know that you're being seen. You know, there is this tendency in our messaging right now, whether or not we're intentional about it, there is this tendency that like, well, you know, it isn't Ebola. It's not a super deadly virus. I'm probably not going to get it. And if I don't, even if I get it, nothing's going to happen to me. That's true. And I believe that, right? I'm a part of that group. But there is a group for whom this is very scary. And some of the messaging, I think, is like, well, you don't really matter. I mean, it's only 10% of the population. So I think that if you are a really healthy, able-bodied person who has, you know, the energy and the resources to help, it might just be as simple as checking in on people who are more vulnerable and being like, hey, how are you feeling right now? You know, like, this is scary. How are you doing? I know you're going through chemo or you have MS or whatever it is. Like, how are you doing? Do you want to just talk over the phone? Like, nothing, connection hasn't been canceled in all of this, right? There's nothing stopping people from opening up their laptops or their phones and FaceTiming people with a cup of coffee in front of their screen and just checking in. So I think that's such a simple and powerful act of community just to see how people are doing, right?
Mm-hmm. Well, we are more connected than ever.
Yeah.
The fact that you and I can have this conversation, you from your home, me from my, you know, it's pretty
coast
amazing.
To coast, I know.
Exactly. Right. We can do this. We can do this with anyone, anywhere, really. And, you know, I've noticed my text messages, have increased in the last week for sure. Everybody checking in with everybody. And, but also I'm trying to remember too, as I'm sure you are, to go a little bit outside of my, mm-hmm. you know, my tight friend box and thinking mm-hmm. about who else do I know like mm-hmm. that might not have somebody who lives in town or might not, yeah. you know, that just needs a hand. You know, you've had your kids watch you go through mm-hmm. Cancer, go through some pretty tough things. So your kids are quite familiar with yeah. anxiety and stress, I'm sure, of their own. How are you talking to them about this pandemic?
This is one of the things I am the most proud of in my life is how I have handled or helped my children navigate all the adversity they've experienced in a very short period of time. I actually have a background in Montessori education, so I had this like decade of experience before I even had my own kids that really set me up for success in this. But the key thing for children, no matter what it is, they need to know what's going on, but they only need to know a tiny bite-sized piece of information as it pertains to their immediate everyday lives. So, you know, with cancer, I rolled it out like a drip funnel, just one moment at a time, like, oh, hey, I just need you to be really tender. We found some kind of weird spot in mommy's breast, and I just need you to be careful when you're cuddling me because it's tender. Oh, remember that lump I was telling you about? Well, I'm going to have it removed, and now I'm going to be a little bit sore from surgery. We just went step by step by step, and I included them at every part of the process. You know, we talked about emotional alchemy. For me, that was really galvanized during cancer because the only option for me was to not be afraid of it, was to not think it was working against me, but to really start to shift my own mindset and my inner environment and appreciate that whatever was happening was going to happen for me in some way, and that I would choose to respond by making every single touch point of cancer really beautiful. So that included, you know, my kids went with me and we chose a beautiful toiletry bag to keep all my chemo meds in. You know, there are tons of chemo meds you have to take mm-hmm. and they all have terrifying names, right? I was terrified to take 2 dethahexomethybiazepans or whatever they're called. But when my children created a chart of like unicorn stickers, it was really fun for me to take 2 unicorn pills and chase that with a couple of rainbows. Suddenly it became this like amazing experience we had together. We had a head shaving party, you know, every single part of it we made really beautiful and celebrated moment by moment, which made it so much easier. So for the pandemic, it was the same thing. It was like, listen, we had plans to go away for March break together, and I don't think that feels like the right thing for us to do anymore. There are a lot of people that we need to help protect. We're going to do the right thing by staying home. And what that looks like is X, Y, and Z. So instead, why don't we, you know, we were going to go to Toronto and spend a few days in the city. Instead of going out for dim sum, why don't we make dumplings at home? And we'll just have like a dim sum night at home. We were going to go to this very cool Korean waffle bar. Why don't I just make waffles here and I'll put sprinkles in them to make it really special. So for my kids, it's just moment by moment, little piece by little piece. I'm very open with them that people are really afraid right now. And here's what it means to have school canceled. This is a really long answer. Sorry, but it's honestly.
No, but it's good information, Leisse. It really is because it's important to know this, right? Yes. Because we are all experiencing something together that is new. That, you know, my mom has not experienced this. Yeah. I never have. And my children haven't. Yeah. So we're all navigating it at the same time, while at the same time trying to protect our children's fear. Because you're right. They can't process things the same way as us. No. They can take it in, you know, steps for sure.
Well, and working off the premise that basically we're all still children, we just mask it in a different way. Everybody is having their own unique reaction to how they're processing it. Sometimes the parental response is to just shut it out and pretend it's not happening and not include their kids. And that's not the right approach because kids 100% feel the energy around them. Other people's approach is to tell their kids everything, and that's not the right approach because they can't filter. Like you and I have a hard time filtering it out. Imagine not having any of the context. They can't do that. So again, little bit by little bit, as it directly affects their own life, I really believe, and I can show you like proof in my own life of how that has proven to be the right choice.
Yeah, I agree 100%. Leisse, just as we're wrapping up, do you think it's possible that we can use this crisis, you know, to come home to our truest selves?
Unequivocally. And like unequivocally, I can't underline that enough. You know, challenge is kind of a fancy word for opportunity. And I think when people confront their, basically when people get very real with their emotional awareness, confront their fears, understand what it is they're actually afraid of here, this is room to heal. This is a crumbling of structures and systems as we've known them, which means, you know, Picasso said every act of creation is first an act of destruction. It's safe to say we're in destruction mode, right? So it's like, okay, that means that the only other option is creation. And I think we are so on the cusp of creating something that we didn't even know was possible because every single human on the globe is involved with it. Mm. Like we've never experienced this, and this is nothing but opportunity. Growing pains are really uncomfortable. Some people are going to get hurt. Some people aren't going to make it through, and that's really difficult in its own right. Most of us are going to. And I think most of us have that responsibility to adapt, to pivot, to experience our feelings in a healthy, productive, forward-moving way, because now is the time for leadership. And leadership, like we've never experienced in our generation and in our society, now is the time for us to establish ourselves as leaders and really use this as the chance we've been waiting for to affect like massive change for all of humans as we know it.
Amazing. And you are a coach, you work online, I'm sure, and many coaches probably do. So this is also a good opportunity for if somebody is feeling quite lonely or scared, that they can reach out. There's lots of places to Absolutely. Reach out online for people. Mm-hmm. Also a really good opportunity. Are there any tips that you have for navigating the healthcare system when you have a compromised immune system? Is there any tips?
I mean, I think the biggest thing is trust. I think you have to believe that you have a team of experts working for your advocacy. They know what they're doing. They know the science. You have to trust that. And you also have to self-advocate. If you feel like your voice is not being heard, I think you have a responsibility to yourself to speak up in a kind, compassionate, graceful way, to really see it as a relationship, as a team environment that you're working together to solve a problem. You can't work against each other. You have to work with each other and understand everybody's maxed out right now. So have like turn up the compassion and turn up the self-awareness that, you know, like I just, something doesn't feel right. Be very open in addressing that in a very compassionate way so that everybody feels like, again, they're moving through this together.
Oh my gosh. I love you. Thank you. Thank you. Really, your voice is so calm and I really connect to everything that you're saying. I think it's really meaningful and important right now. So I can't thank you enough for sharing some of your hard-earned wisdom with us, you know, because that's what it is, hard-earned wisdom. Thank you. Really appreciate it, Leisse. Thank you. Well, I want to thank Leisse for sharing her time and advice with us today on TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. Be sure to join us each week as we speak to a wide variety of guests to help support Canadians during the COVID-19 pandemic. Stay well.